Hey everybody, welcome to Get to Know Your Wedding Pro. My name is Reed with Best Made Videos. We are a wedding videography company based out of West Seattle, Washington. And I am joined today by, this has to be the record now in terms of appearances, both through planning and through the WIPA Seattle event or podcast. We have Rebecca Grant, owner of Twin Willow Gardens. Thank you so much for coming on. I know we've talked about, you know, getting you on again to kind of talk about the venue and your journey. And then we've seen each other a lot lately in Snohomish and at the WIPA event last week. And so thanks again for coming on. Why don't you introduce yourself and tell us who you are and what you do?
Awesome. Thanks for having me again. Lucky number three. I think I need to open up another business so I can be on here for time number four and beyond. But for those of you that have not heard my other podcasts with Reed, my name is Rebecca Grant, and I am the owner of two businesses, as well as on the WIPA board as the director of membership. The businesses that I own through the planning company is New Creations Wedding Design and Coordination. And what I'm here to talk to Reed about today is our new venture, which my husband and I just purchased our own wedding venue up in Snohomish, Washington, called Twin Willow Gardens.
Yeah, and this is really exciting. I know this is a journey that you guys have been on for a long time, trying to kind of figure out what you wanted to do. I was thinking, though, first off, you're coming on the podcast. I wanted to drop a hot quiz for you.
Uh-oh.
and if you fail too bad, we'll cut this part out. Do you remember the first time that we ever worked together?
Oh, gosh. Oh, my gosh.
No. I had to look at
I don't.
It was almost 6 years ago. It was May 23rd at Meridian Valley Country
Club. Oh, yes. Pepsi and Edelin.
Yes, it was.
Yes.
I couldn't remember the name of the venue, but I remembered them. And we're still, I think he and I are still Facebook friends.
Oh, my gosh. That's awesome.
But it's been a long time.
Yes, it has been.
My point is. So you've been wedding planning for a long time. What was it about wanting to own a venue? Kind of, totally different, obviously, like, web of whatever to get into. So what was the thought process behind that?
Yeah. So when I started wedding planning way back when, 16 years ago, when I was living in Hawaii and going to school at UH Manoa, I ended up working for a wedding planner on the island who still to this day is my mentor and pretty much taught me everything I know. But with that, we got to talking about kind of what longevity within this industry looked like and kind of what my next steps were. And she was the one that told me, like, Rebecca, never name your business after yourself, because if you want to sell it, who's going to buy your brand because it's so associated with you. And I was like, that was probably the biggest takeaway that I got from her as just a business owner. And so with that, as I kind of moved through my wedding planning career, venue ownership has literally always been my next step. It's always been something that I've been really intrigued by and interested in. And it was kind of, even going back even further into like my high school years, I had always pictured like growing up having a really bustling house and always had the love of entertaining and that type of thing. But on the flip side, I knew that I never wanted to have kids. And so as I was growing up, I'm like, well, where is this love of having this crazy, big entertainment house and, not having the family that kind of tends to come along with that? Where does that play into my life? And so then kind of, fast forward a few years as I graduated and got into college a little bit later on in life and went to school for wedding planning, it really started coming to fruition of like, oh my gosh, this is my dream, but it's just coming to me a very different route, like where I don't need to be the one providing the family to have that happen. People are coming to me and having that happen at my home and now at our property. And so being able to host just wonderful events, of course, quite often the greatest day of people's lives. And it's really a privilege. And that's been just kind of always the next step. And so when my husband and I really actively started talking about it about 3 years ago now, to get pretty serious about starting to look for properties, we kind of just did a lot in the background, looked online. We worked with a real estate agent who is a friend of ours to go look at properties. And I'm not kidding you. We literally looked at hundreds of properties. And in person, we probably looked at about 40 to 50 properties all the way from like Skagit Valley all the way down south to like Tacoma, Gig Harbor, and everywhere in between. So it's definitely been a journey for sure.
Yeah, because I mean, that always kind of is, you know, the dream, right? I think a lot of vendors talk about that or, you know, say, hey, at some point we want to, I'm going to open that, you know, photographer is always talking. And so it's, you know, but it's rare to really make that step and make that leap. And I know that obviously there was a lot of research between, you know, starting a new place or do you buy something or do you, whatever that is. And so what was it about your venue that made that kind of all that click together?
Yeah. So the biggest one and, you know, kind of the biggest piece of advice I have for those that really see venue ownership as their next step is the biggest hurdle and roadblock for me was finances. I'm like, how do we make this happen? Because, you know, Seattle's not cheap. And the areas that we were looking in, quite honestly, were anywhere between the $3 to $4 million mark for a piece of property that had zero infrastructure on it, let alone any permitting or anything else that it takes to get a wedding venue up off the ground. So that was something that we were kind of looking at of like, oh my gosh, how are we going to actually make this happen? And once kind of fast forward to now, you know, after those 3 years of looking at properties, kind of how everything fell into place was pretty quite unbelievable. We had just started putting it out on social media about a year ago through my New Creations Instagram page of showing people the different properties we were looking at and saying like, hey, do you know, what do you think about this one? This is where it's located. This is where I picture the ceremony. This is where I picture the reception. And really starting to put it out there that this was my next step. I think my greatest fear was people thinking that I wasn't going to be doing planning anymore, which, you know, even someday I won't, but not anytime soon. And so I just kind of got comfortable in my own skin enough to put that out into the world and show people that this is my next step. And it was because I started putting it out there that was the pivot point for me. So I was at a wedding actually on a Friday night. I had Andrea Harrison, who for those of you in the industry know her, she used to be at Red Hook and then she is a part-time planner with Pink Blossom Events, also a good friend of mine. She was my assistant that day at a wedding and had started hearing through the grapevine that Twin Willow Gardens was coming up for sale. And it was not only her, but I had three other people text me that same day that said, we just heard Twin Willow is coming up for sale. This is your property. You need to buy it. And they're like, okay. So that was a Friday. We made an appointment with the previous owners the following Monday. And this is kind of one of those things where it was just a total meant to be. We had been residents of Snohomish for 6 years, and this property was 2 miles down the road. It was actually 7 minutes away from where we used to live. So we didn't have to change our community at all. So when we met with the owners, we spent about 4 hours with them, just kind of going over all the nitty-gritty. We asked to see P&Ls. We asked to see what the expenses were for the upcoming year. We asked to see, you know, what their inquiry system was like, all of the back-end logistics. You know, it wasn't a super fun, upbeat meeting, but it was one that you need to know, you know, to go into a business. So they said, let us know if you'd like to make an offer. We do have other people interested in the property, but we are more interested in finding the right fit of who's going to really bring this property to the next level versus just whoever comes up with the cash the quickest. So Brian and I talked about it, decided that, yeah, we're going to go for it. And that Tuesday, we made an official offer. How we financed it, because again, this was my biggest sticking point of like, how are we actually going to do this? So I really want to help give encouragement to those that are looking at that this is possible. Brian and I did have to sell our house in order to come up with a down payment to put on this property. So we were in a bit of limbo and a bit of really like heart-wrenching time between our house sold in 26 hours. And so, but we had not made an official contract with Twin Willow yet. So there was a brief period of time where we did not have a home to live in. So if anything dropped through at any given point, we would be out of a home that we loved. We would not be able to buy the property. And we would have to start over from square one. So that was incredibly nerve-wracking and came with a ton of risk. But we also wanted to make sure that we had the appropriate contracts in place that were both appeasing to the previous owners and to us on the purchase of the property before officially moving forward. So that's what the holdup was during that time of selling our home to officially getting under contract with the previous owners of Twin Willow.
And because you guys had built your house, right? The one that you guys lived in before. So, I mean, there was just a lot of
a ton of emotional connection there. Yeah. We had personally put in the backyard ourselves. We'd built our chicken coop, which was also a shed. We adored our neighbors. We loved our view. So it was a very hard home to leave. And the day we actually moved out, Brian and I were both just train wrecks. I mean, we were bawling and, you know, it was a tough process. I'm not going to lie. It was really hard to make that decision and to decide that, yeah, this is where we want our future to go.
Yeah. You know, and that's the thing too, with, you know, buying a house is, you know, huge anyway, right? I mean, it's one of the biggest purchases anybody will ever make anyway, let alone, you know, buying a, you know, a business and a venue. And I mean, it's just exponentially more and more, right?
Yep, exactly. And luckily, you know, out of all the properties that we had looked at over time, you know, like I said, they either had zero infrastructure or the house that was on property would have been a complete teardown, or we would have had to build from the ground up. So again, just one of those moments of like, this was absolutely meant to be. This house that was happens to be on the property itself was very, very similar aesthetic to the old house that we had to sell in order to afford this one. Because of my connection with Andrea, I had actually been to that home before. I had actually planned weddings on that property before. So I really felt like I was stepping into something that was a little bit more known rather than having to, you know, out of the properties that we had looked at, coming into a complete brand new space. And I think that would have been completely overwhelming, both just personally and also financially. And this one was just, it was the right price. It was the right experience for us. It was the right neighborhood for us. You know, just again, one of those weird things. We've since met our neighbors and had them over for dinner because we wanted to be sure that we were respectful of them having to be next to a wedding venue for the past 12 years. And it turns out like the husband went to the same college as my husband. The wife is actually my primary care physician. I don't know if she's going to be anymore. That's a little too close for comfort. But I mean, it was just like just a complete moment of everything melding together in the perfect right way, the perfect right timing. And we've been really lucky to be in this home and on this specific property. And yeah, it has its quirks to it. I mean, it's not a semi-custom home that we built by any means. It's a 12-year-old home, but we are able to put our personal touches on it, and it is quite a lovely home, and it feels like us. So we were very lucky to fall into that.
Yeah, I was going to ask you if you had ever planned weddings there before. So obviously you had, and so that just has to be a really weird. I don't know. I just couldn't imagine. Like, I don't know. It's just we're that kind of. How you would ever experience that another way. If you had like friends that had a house and you had had a party there and then you ended up buying that.
Right.
You
know,
it's right. It's an interesting thing. So what is it about the venue that you love or kind of made you fall in love with it just in terms of like the actual wedding aspect of it?
Yeah. So when I had planned weddings there, it was actually pretty funny because I had never planned a wedding there until this past 2019. And I actually had three weddings there. And the first one happened right as we were going through negotiations of purchasing the property. So I couldn't tell anybody that we were thinking about buying this property. But of course, I was looking at it through a totally different lens. But really, the appeal to this property is I'm a pretty avid gardener. Like, you'll quite often find me on days off out in the garden weeding or planting new flowers or whatever. This is a full outdoor garden venue. And the one thing that like 100% sets apart from pretty much any other venue in Western Washington is the ceremony area. For those of you that have seen the Twilight wedding, it is the wedding in the woods. It is that wedding. It's completely surrounded by beautiful old growth hemlocks and maples and fir trees and pine trees, just completely surrounding the ceremony area. So it makes it feels super intimate, really quiet. And then as you expand out onto the rest of the property, it's beautiful garden venue. And I'm just excited to kind of get my hands on those gardens and make them our own. We moved in October 1st, and we've been, you know, kind of getting gardens cut back for spring growth. And we have found quite a few treasures in the gardens that were at one point treasures. We are now seeing them a little bit on the trashy side. So we've been pulling all those out. But it's like radio flyer red wagons, or like light up mushrooms, or little fairies. We found quite a few birdhouses, a full Adirondack chair that has kind of like melted into the garden. So we're trying to kind of put our own stamp on it and make it ours. And with that too, we've also expanded the season a little bit based on what the previous owners were doing. So we're actually opening up our first wedding is May 1st, and we go through the middle of October. So with that, like a really high priority to me is to get a lot of like spring blooming flowers and fall blooming flowers into the gardens too, just to put our stamp on it and also make sure that there's color, you know, all throughout the year.
That's exciting. Yeah. I've yet to shoot a wedding there. We have two there this summer. So nice. I'm excited. We'll join you out there in June and September. It's just cool to, I don't know, take what was there. And then obviously with your expertise, really like expand stuff, because you know, I think it's one thing if you own a venue and you've been there a long time where you've, you know, seen a lot of different things and seen what works and what doesn't work. It's just, you know, just kind of a fresh perspective to bring it in there, right?
For sure. And that was one of the things too, from a planner perspective, that when I walked onto the property, I knew exactly what needed to be done and exactly what the priority was. So like, for instance, in the tiny homes that is typically reserved for the ladies to get ready in, they had a back room that was a bedroom that had one single overhead light and then a lamp. And that's where they expected all the ladies to do hair and makeup. And it's like, well, that's way too dark. I know that from a photography perspective, a videography perspective, and also just being a woman, you know, like you cannot do your hair and makeup in super, super dim lighting. And so the very first upgrade we made was actually purchasing 360 light up mirrors and adding three of those to the back room. And now when ladies come in that do tours with us, they walk back there and it's really fun to overhear them all go, oh my God, gosh, this is amazing. You know, it's just those little touches that most people don't think of, but because I have been in the wedding industry, like I know what needs to be done. Same thing with adding a dress hook, you know, so that way photographers and videographers have the ability to get that dress shot. Previously there wasn't any, now there is. And, you know, throughout the property, we're just for this coming season, we're making slow but steady progress with those upgrades. We've added more lighting to the catering kitchen to make it easier for the caterers. We've added a break area for the vendors, whereas before there was no place for them to kind of retreat and get a break. So we've added a tent with light and heat and a table and chairs for, you know, vendors to be able to just get off their feet for a little bit, go take their break. And then we've also added pipe and drape in front of the kitchen area to make sure that the caterers, you know, don't have to have full visibility into the cleanup process and all that stuff with all the guests watching. And then the biggest upgrades that we've actually made are to the tent. So we do have a 40 by 60 tent on property that we do own. So once the season kicks off May 1st, it'll be up and it'll be up through the middle of October. But the three things that we've really changed onto the tent were we've added two chandeliers to the tent. We've added a flat tent liner. So it'll be really clean and crisp and you won't see the, you know, under rigging of the tent. And then the two, they're called gable ends to the tent, which is basically the triangle piece of the ends. Those were solid white canvas and we've changed those out to be clear to let a ton more light in and make your photo and video look way better.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I prefer to awkwardly stand and have my break in the corner in full view of the guests, but I guess.
Awesome. Well, you don't need to take advantage of the break area then. We'll let other people do that.
That's awesome. No, that sounds great. No, but it's those small touches that, you know, like, again, most people would not think of having like a room for the vendors to totally. Like put their stuff, right? Yes. So it's not
out in the middle of everywhere.
Or blocking the caterer. But, you know, it's just little nice touches like that, that I think are exciting. Yeah. It's funny. Like, I think there's a lot of venues where anybody goes in vendor and you're like, oh man, I really like this place, but you know, the getting ready room kind of is tough, or like ceremony's a little tight here, or whatever it is. And now it's like, you can go in and like literally like make these tweaks.
Yeah.
Where, you know, I bet a lot of vendors wish they could do that at a lot of different venues. You know, just little things.
Yeah. And the people that we've had come up on the vendor side to come up and tour the property, you know, at the end they'll be like, oh man, I wish all wedding venues were owned by planners or by other wedding vendors, because we know what needs to go in. And it doesn't really affect necessarily the couple, but the vendors are so appreciative of it that it makes it more exciting for them to work there, like you said. And I for sure want to leverage my relationships and my experience within, you know, my planning side for the past, gosh, since 2009 here in Seattle, and then beyond that in Hawaii. But, you know, I for sure want to leverage those relationships that I've built over the last decade and be able to have people say like, oh my gosh, Rebecca's killing it out at Twin Willow and you need to go do this venue because she's thought of everything. Like, that's honestly what my goal is to really just have people get excited to be out there.
Well, and that's the thing too. And I think it goes back to, you know, just being a planner and thinking of those things. And, you know, as someone that, you know, I had to convince Dorothy, you know, to hire you, right, to have a planner, you know, there's little things, I mean, with every vendor, but there's little things that come along that maybe as a couple you don't realize, but overall, like the whole experience is just more seamless. And that was even like, you know, when we were getting married and you would point things out and I'm like, well, I didn't even think about that. And I'm a vendor. And so I think it's that same where, you know, the one plus one plus one, but it's the whole that just ends up feeling like, oh yeah, this is a really cohesive day, and just kind of everything just went smooth, right?
Yeah, just those little touches and little thought processes, you know. And we, one of the changes that we did make, that we are requiring a planner to be on site for the weddings, because it's not a turnkey venue. You know, you can't just open up the door to the ballroom and say, have at it. You do have to bring in rentals. There, you know, we provide the tent and the space and the tables and chairs, but if, you know, you've got to bring in all your place settings and all your linens and all that stuff. So we are trying to make it really easy for the couple to be, you know, we're requiring this because it is going to make it easier on you. And are you going to be the one handling rentals? I don't think so. You know, so just really trying to help them through. Yes, this is a requirement. So you might see upfront, you know, dollar signs, but ultimately it's going to be a much, much better experience. And it's going to be just so much of a smoother day on their end, you know, working with the planner. And then also for us as venue owners, like, I don't want to fall into the role of being that person's planner, you know, because it's going to be pretty easy for me to do that, of seeing kind of where the gaps are missing and wanting to step in. And my hope is that with requiring planners, that we can truly act as what a venue owner and manager should be acting as, you know, and not be the hovering and not be, you know, we want to be pretty hands off and quite honest, you know, it just really trusting our vendors that are on site and really just knowing that they've got it. And we'll come down and do our bathroom checks every hour and, you know, touch base, make sure everything's going well. But other than that, we really just want it to be a fun experience for people that come on property.
Well, and that's the big thing, is because, you know, I've worked at a lot of venues like that where the, you know, the owners are really hands-on, you know, for better or worse. And, it, you know, it's always that fine line where you have someone that is like coordinating, doing entrances and stuff. Right. And you're like, okay, well, this is really like a totally different role now.
Than, yes.
You know, or like, or, you know, maybe I want to rent, you know, I want to be at a venue and I want to choose my planner, right? You know,
right.
And not have whoever happens to own the place
exactly
be part of, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
it is that
for sure.
there's a lot of different kind of layers with
that. Yeah, and that's one of the biggest things like that I'm trying to tell my colleagues of planners, is that I am not the built-in planner. Like, I want them to bring other planners to the property. I want that feedback, you know, like I want other planners' perspectives on, is there anything that we could be doing better as venue owner, you know, to be able to make your life easier. Plus, like, I don't want to shoot myself in the foot. I want their referrals. You know, I don't want to be like, oh, Rebecca's in-house exclusive planner because she owns her own planning company. So why would I ever refer a planner up there? Right. Or why would I ever refer a couple up there? I want that community to really rally around us. And, you know, that's one of the biggest, like most exciting things about really taking on this undertaking is that, you know, our community has come around us and has been super supportive and really excited to see where we're taking it. So I want to leverage those relationships again. I'm not going to be the exclusive in-house planner. Come on up. If you're a planner, I want you. And we are also requiring every vendor that steps foot on property has to be licensed and insured. We are very, very much trying to elevate the Snohomish wedding market because it is a destination for people. You would be shocked to hear the amount of people that come up. We had a couple drive up from Olympia last weekend to come see our venue. That's an hour and a half drive. And the amount of South Sound people that are coming up blows my mind, you know, so it very much is a destination area for people. And there's plenty of DIY venues out in the Snohomish market. If that's your jam and if that's the route you want to go, there's plenty of venues out there for you. It's just not going to be us. We do want you to have a really, really seamless experience, both on the client side and both on the vendor side. So that's why we do want our vendors to be professional and play by the rules. You know, we want them to be licensed and insured and know that they're protecting not only themselves, but our couples, as well as us as venue owners.
Yeah, it's crazy. I just had posted a blog this week up in Everett wedding, and a lot of their, like the dress and rings and stuff were all down in Federal Way. Yeah. And I was like, oh, they must have lived in Federal Way, right? I mean, I don't necessarily pay attention, but, you know, but using, going up and traveling up and using, you know, like you said, using that area as a destination. Yeah. I was like, oh, that's fascinating, you know, because it is really just, I mean, over the last, I don't know, 5-6, I mean, at least since I've been in the industry, like really kind of expanding out. Totally. It's crazy.
Yeah. And I would say like, that's really a testament to, the Snohomish Wedding Guild. Honestly, they've really put a ton of effort into getting Snohomish as a destination and really on the map. And putting together the Snohomish wedding tour, like that was a huge undertaking, and they've done a fabulous job at promoting Snohomish as a destination wedding market. But you know, so with those people coming up from down south, every time we give a tour, I ask, oh, where did you drive in from? And, you know, a lot of the time it's Kirkland or Lake Stevens or, you know, somewhere fairly close by. But then generally every Sunday when we give a tour, there's somebody that comes in from Gig Harbor or Tacoma or Olympia or, you know, somewhere way, way far south. And I'm like, what? Why would you not do something down there? But okay, thanks for coming, you know? And more often than not, they book. And it's really neat to see that be a destination area. And hopefully that, you know, Brian and my passion for owning this venue is really showing through to them of like, we are really trying to elevate your experience. We are really trying to give you the best day possible.
What was the reaction like? I mean, besides obviously excitement with, you know, when this all came about, you know, what did people think? I mean, I remember Dorothy and I were excited, you know, we watched the Instagram live, whatever it was.
Right?
But I mean, what was that like to kind of really announce this and, you know, so many years and just, you know, countless hours of time and everything?
It's very surreal. And I think a big portion of that is because we haven't officially started our wedding season yet. You know, since we are a seasonal venue, May through October, right now we're in the easy side. Right now we're just in the tours and the bookings and cutting back the gardens for the spring. But I think it's going to really hit us when we have that first wedding in May 1st, you know, and be like, holy crap, we actually did this. And it is pretty amazing to see our community really rally around us and the amount of offers we've gotten from people to like, hey, if you need a new promo video, hit me up. Like, we'll totally do that for you. If you need new promo images, we've got you. And it's just a testament to really how collaborative the Seattle wedding community really is. Like, we're all in this together, you know, and it's really exciting to see people just be so supportive of somebody's dream coming to reality. I mean, it's pretty awesome, actually. So it's been a fun journey for sure. And being able to share that with my community has been awesome.
So Brian, your husband, right? And, you know, obviously, kind of in the industry with, you know, having a wife as a planner.
By proxy.
And doing all this. Right. But now, I mean, he really is kind of helping alongside. What has that transition been like for him? And what's it been like?
Oh, man. So I would not have been able to do this had he not been 100% in with me. His full-time job is IT for Starbucks. He's been with the company for 17 years now. That has been his livelihood for a very long time. But I mean, obviously, this is a decision together and we're married, and it would, of course, change his life too. You know, he's also giving up the home that he helped build and loved in order to make this happen for my dream. And he's been both feet in, I mean, unbelievable with handling emails. He does most of our email communications. We've split up giving tours. If we can, we try and give tours together, but just based on my schedule or his schedule, sometimes we've got to split up. So he's been doing that and killing it. But the funny part is, you know, like, since this has been my dream for so long, I'm like, okay, when this actually happens, what does that next 3 to 5 year plan look like? Is it me phasing out of the planning side and being able to hand over to my team? And that's, again, specifically why I have a team, is because I've always envisioned being able to sell the company to them. So like, that's kind of been my 3 to 5 years, like, okay, you know, by probably by like 2022, 2023, I could see myself slowly pulling out and fading back a little bit. You know, I'll be in my mid 40s by that point. So I'm like, yeah, perfect timing. So now the conversation is, Brian keeps bringing up, so if I retire from Starbucks, I was like, this is not your dream. You're messing up the plan. Like, why are you talking about retiring from Starbucks? You know, and it's a conversation that we seriously need to have, because if he truly is wanting to give the venue his all in, you know, that's a big change for us, because then that's health benefits going by the wayside. That's 401k. You know, Starbucks matches it. That goes by the wayside. 30% off discount every time you're at Starbucks. That goes away. Free pound of coffee a week. Steady paycheck. You know, like, all of those things go away. And basically, we would both be self-employed by that point. And yes, the economy is amazing now, and we're getting consistent bookings now, but what does that look like in another 3 years? You know, is there going to be a downturn in the wedding market? Is there going to be a recession that we're going to hit, and it's going to affect weddings or events? You know, so really talking about what that looks like and being really careful financially. And Brian and I have been incredibly lucky to be 100% debt-free, with the exception of our house and, of course, now the business, for our entire marriage. And that is a really big thing for us, to really just live within our means and make sure that we are putting a 6-month emergency fund away and making sure that we are contributing to retirement. So it's just, it's a very adult conversation, and not one that is super exciting to have. But now that he's starting to kink in the plans, I'm like, oh gosh, now we have to figure out, like, does that look like both of us retiring in the next 5 years and going full into the venue, or does that mean I keep planning? Like, I don't know. So, don't know what the next step is. And that's something that I've shared with Brian, is that now that I've hit what has always been my next step of owning the venue, I don't know what's next. Like, I'm a little bit lost about, like, is it opening up a second venue? Is it going into consulting? You know, what does that look like? Like, what is the next step in the next few years? So I don't know. We'll see.
No, it's tough. We just, our episode that'll go tomorrow, Tiffany with Sweet Pea Beauty, we were talking about that, about just aging up in the industry. Yep. And am I going to be like a 50-year-old wedding videographer?
Totally.
Like, hey guys, like, you know, rolling into the bridal suite. You know, it's real conversations. And I do think a lot of the vendors that listen, I mean, a lot of people are thinking the same thing, right?
Yeah,
and as you get older, and where does that look like?
Totally.
And, you know, and just if the market changes, I mean, it's just a lot of stuff. It's a lot of real conversations.
Yeah. And it's, you know, you're absolutely right. Like, this is not an industry for old people. It really isn't. I mean, it is so physically and mentally demanding on you that it's very rare to see anybody over the age of 60 still going strong, right? Like, in all honesty. And so it's getting out before you're too old to get out. And you should have, you know, everybody's like, oh man, she should have been out of planning years ago. You know, I don't want that to happen. I want to get out while I'm still on top. And my husband is telling me, well, you're going so strong right now. Why in the world do you want to get out of planning? And I'm like, because I want to get out when I'm still good. You know, like, I don't want to be one of those people that's like, again, she should have gotten out years ago. And, you know, my team is just as strong as me. And so I just really see them as kind of the next up and comers and the next generation. And I've trained them with everything I know. So why not? Why not hand that off to them? But yeah, no immediate plans. I mean, Brian and I definitely have a financial goal that we need to hit before anything changes with either one of our jobs. But once we hit that goal, then it's okay, let's have that serious conversation. But I also want to be sure that we have an exit plan. You know, I want to be sure that the ducks are in a row for if I do sell my company to one of my associate planners. And if Brian does decide to retire from Starbucks, what does that look like for us? So just...
Yeah. Cause I mean, there's obviously just, balances of everything, you know, lots of time and, or lack of time and, you know, trying to figure out how to, you know, how to plan and run a company and do everything else. And I look at people that have kids and I'm like, I don't know how, it's crazy. So that's exciting.
Yeah. So we'll see. We'll see what the next few years. And like I said, maybe that'll be my fourth company and then I'll come back on for my fourth episode with you. Talking about, remember what I was saying 3 to 5 years ago, what the next step was? Here it is.
No, but I mean, like, and like you're talking about, you know, leveraging, you know, the business that you have as a planning company, you know, to other people. I mean, that's the same thing, right? We're taking over the venue because a lot of people, and I was going to bring this up earlier, you know, but, you know, besides like all the permitting and stuff, I mean, just inheriting the venue that like is established and like is part of the Snohomish wedding, everything, you know, like there's so much that people like, if you have not started a business of any kind, like there's so many things, like even besides like owning the house and owning all the like SEO and having a domain and like all this stuff that goes into it that I just don't even think that people think about where you're, well, obviously you have to, if you're balancing that, you know, starting something new versus inheriting, you know, or not inheriting, but, you know, purchasing something that's, it's tough, right? There's a lot of, you know, the cost on one end versus the time on the other.
Totally. And we were very lucky to be able to, you know, inherit 42 weddings upon booking or upon purchasing the venue. We're now up to 65 weddings. We only have 7 open dates in 2020 and we're booking for 2021 very strong right now. So yes, we were incredibly lucky to inherit something that had a great reputation and I would not have bought the venue had it not had a good reputation and be able to have existing bookings already, you know, income coming in for us right away versus having a little bit of a lag time of having to build our own property, get the permits, build the website, do all the marketing. Like that's a huge undertaking. And then one of the things that I think a lot of people don't think about, which was our hardest struggle actually, was insurance because we have a residential and a commercial on the same property. And a lot of insurance companies get a little bit like, we don't know how to do that. We don't want to insure you. So that was the biggest struggle for us was actually finding an insurance company that would cover us. And then because we are seasonal and we have the 2 tiny homes on property, I actually wanted to look into utilizing those as a VRBO through the off season. And insurance like laughed at us. They're like, yeah, right. We're already insuring you for residential and commercial. And now you want to throw a rental into that? No way. So we're holding off on that for now. But it was there's a lot. I mean, there was a ton of paperwork to go through. You know, from the seller, they had lawyers on their side. Us as the buyer, we had lawyers on our side. Of course, both wanting to make changes. Because we were also buying a home and a venue, we had to have home and venue inspectors coming out. Right now we're in the throes of interviewing landscapers, because we know like as I get into my season, I've got I just booked my 30th wedding for this year. So I'm going to have 30 weddings through new creations. I know once the venue gets going, like we can't maintain that property ourselves. And so we're interviewing that and those bids are coming in at like $25,000 to $35,000, you know, so it's a lot of, okay, where do we want to put our money? How much can we realistically do ourselves? And, you know, how much should we really rely on professionals for? So there's certainly a lot of moving pieces to it, for sure. And again, luckily we've had the community around us. I've been able to, you know, kind of partner with court to have our tent in storage and get that cleaned and maintained. And we've been learning a lot about tents, you know, more than I ever knew from a planning side and just really trying to ask the right questions and talk to the right people. But man, if somebody, you know, somebody out there is like, oh, I have a pretty backyard, I'm going to open up my own wedding venue. There is a lot to think about. And I mean, I've been in this industry for a long time and it was still even a lot for me. And I just can't even imagine somebody brand new coming into this expecting to know what to do. There's no way. So that's why I've thought about going into consulting.
No, but I mean, it's crazy though, because, and like you said, you know, you wanted to find a place that, you know, did have a good reputation. Because I do think, you know, there's people that like, oh, I'm going to take over something that's maybe on the dumps and kind of, I'm going to turn it around. Or trying to start something and dealing with neighbors. I mean, like you said, you know, getting to know your neighbors. I mean, obviously this place has been here 12 years, like, that's kind of established now versus like, hey, we're just going to open this up.
Totally.
Like, hope that's okay.
Yeah.
You know, and I mean, and I've heard horror stories from a lot of people that are doing stuff like that, that have really struggled to get all the necessary paperwork and permits and everything that they have. But you know, it's funny, you were talking about the, you know, the landscaping. I had just filmed this, presentation a week ago. And it was, the big thing was about, you know, buying time when you can, that's like the only, finite, commodity that we have anymore. Cause it was really fascinating, but it used to be like people wanted to do all this stuff and they didn't have the money or the means or anything to like, you know, take their kids to do whatever or go on vacation or go do all these different things. And now it's like, we all have the money to do it, but nobody has the time.
Right.
And so it's, you know, really utilizing the, you know, the money and like you said, the connections and stuff that you have to kind of leverage that to get that time back. Cause it is going to be a big, you know, change
huge
coming into this year.
Yeah, absolutely. It really is. And it's, you know, I'm a big fan of, I outsource a lot, even through my planning company. I've got two virtual assistants that work for me. And then I've got a gal that I sometimes throw admin work to when I'm feeling super overwhelmed about something, is like, here, I need you to take this on so I can just get caught up. And that's what we're trying to figure out, where that tipping point is for the venue side of, okay, do we need a venue manager? Do we need a landscaping crew? You know, who can we leverage, and really where do we need to throw our dollars to be sure that we are surviving? You know, especially this year is going to be the roughest, because not only do I, of course, have a full planning load still, but it's also between old contract and new contract. So this is going to be kind of the bumpy year. The old, you know, owners did not require a planner. And so we are getting a lot of families that are doing the cleanup themselves and doing the flowers themselves. And, you know, it's going to be interesting to really be gracious to them, but also have them understand that this is a business and things do have to be cleaned up and you do have to be out on time, you know? So this is going to be kind of the rough year. But I think once we get into 2021, we're fully, you know, our requirements come into play, it's going to be a little bit easier. And even at that, we'll always be learning. You know, I mean, I remember when I first started my planning company, my contract was 3 pages long and now it's 12. So, you know, there's always things that we're going to be learning along the way for sure.
Yeah. I was just telling you before we started, I just had to add in a whole new thing going into this year because of stuff. And, you know, you never think, every year, I think there's always been like one wedding where I'm like, oh, man, I'm going to add that in it. And you're like, wow, I would not like to know that that was my wedding that made you, you know, someone have to add a whole new clause to the contract.
Exactly. Yeah. Very, very true.
This has been a fascinating conversation today. You know, thank you so much for coming in and making time. Is there anything else you wanted to touch on before we go?
We're really excited for you to come out and see the property. If you do want to see it, definitely shoot me an email either through my info at newcreationsweddings.com email or our weddings@twinwillowgardens.com email. And we can get a tour set up, but I'd love to be able to show other vendors our new property. And if you're a client looking for a beautiful outdoorsy twilight wedding in the woods or a garden venue, definitely feel free to set up a tour. We do tours every Sunday. You get a homemade chocolate chip cookie if you come out and tour with us. So it's been a nice little perk for people. But we're enjoying it so far.
And it is so great to see Brian out at events. I know he was at the Snohomish meeting we were at, I guess, 2 weeks ago now. But it's great to see, you know.
He's totally out of his element.
but it's good.
He's doing it. Yeah, he's doing great.
And also just, and you've just been able to host a lot of different, you know, professional kind of networking events, both kind of in the home and even on the property, right?
Yeah. So we've hosted Wedding Network USA, which last August was when we officially announced that we were the new owners of that property. There's also been Snohomish Wedding Guild meetings that have been held out there. And then right after we took over, we moved on property October 1st. And a couple of weeks later, we actually hosted our first friend and vendor open house to be able to come out and refresh your memory on what the property looks like or see it for the first time. And then, of course, we also wanted to share our home with people too. So invited them up to that. And we had an awesome vendor team to help put that together for us. And it was nice to kind of have a really great kickoff to our year.
Awesome. Well, this is lots of excitement. And I just am so appreciative of you wanting to come on and kind of share the word.
For sure.
So it's been great. Thanks again for taking the time. If you're like Rebecca and you're interested in coming on the podcast and sharing your story, you can go to www.bestmadevideos.com/podcastguest. And that's a nice, easy questionnaire. And it came in. I was sitting in front of my email. Rebecca Kraft said, what's going on here? And she and even took the time to fill out the questionnaire again to come on as doing the venue. So I really appreciate that.
Absolutely.
This has been another episode of Get to Know Your Wedding Pro. Check back next week for another wedding vendor interview. Thanks so much.
Thank you.